I've done a lot of talking today, so I'm kind of, my voice isn't, won't be nearly as strong as Inky's. First things first, if you could turn your cell phones off or electronic devices, that'd be awesome, so we don't get interrupted with that. I will tell you the video volume isn't quite where we want it. The link isn't quite there, so you'll have to really listen. Both screens will be working for that. It's just been an awesome day. We had talks this morning at Century and JM, and you're in for a real treat. And there's going to be a question and answer opportunity at the end. Please ask the questions because the kids lined up today. I didn't think kids would line up and ask questions, and they did. And it was really awesome. So it's been a fun day. I want to thank these sponsors that made this happen, because really these are the ones that paid to go to the high schools and also paid to be at the event center tonight and tomorrow. Anybody's welcome. As you can see, we have plenty of seating. So we had no idea how many people would turn out tonight. But I guarantee you'll be a better person when you leave. And I'd like to thank Think Bank. They do so much in our community. I'd like to thank City Auto Glass and Titan Development, which is the Hilton Hotel and Doubletree and Andy's Liquor and several other organizations. And then, of course, I got to thank the Canadian Honker Restaurant Catering and the Event Center. Wes told me I had to say that. And Rochester Area Foundation was our nonprofit piece. Because see, this is three guys sitting down having a cup of coffee. They came up with this concept. Instead of working through society and being negative, we're trying to bring something positive to the community itself. And but we needed a nonprofit arm in order for these organizations to donate to help us out on this. So Rochester Area Foundation was helpful in that. Please watch the video.
Owen, until 7 years old, discovered he wanted to become an NFL player. He used to get up with his father on Saturday morning at 5:30. He used to run miles. First time in the sophomore season, he tore ligaments his out for his senior year. He broke his clap in the first year out for the season. College scouts would come in the senior year and say, man, you're extremely talented. The rules, you better make it out of high school, let alone college. He said, son, there's no way that you will make it. Coach Philip Fulmer from the University of Tennessee came in at Grimm High School and offered a scholarship to the University of Tennessee. He said, coach, a reporter was making a beeline to Johnson. He even think you're going to play at the University of Tennessee as a starting coach. You played a little bit to refresh yourself. You'll see if you can get a coach starting. I've got a strong effect. I've always seen another game. I've been up to 15 pounds. You call your brother big more important. You say, after this year, our lives are about to change. For our second game, you guys are better. You guys are on yourself. You're a boss. Fourth quarter, Air Force had just been down one side. Stop. I'm standing between you and the rest of your life. Where do your strength come from? Where do your drive come from? Where do your motivation come from? Where do your perseverance come from? Everything that you've ever been through, everything that you've ever faced, you've had the ability to overcome. You had the ability to persevere. Everybody that ever made a sacrifice in your life, everybody that ever believed in you, everybody that ever gave you an opportunity in your life, you can't let them down. And I can't stop you. I can't stop you. Even if I wanted to, I can't stop you because you're about to get stronger.
Tennessee player,
Zinky
Johnson, is down.
People ask you all the time, if you can go back to September 9th, 2006, that game against Air Force, and you can stop that moment, or you cannot play in that game, or you knew this situation was about to happen, would you change it? I can't stop this moment because of the people that believed in you, the people that sacrificed so much for you, the people that saw something in you. You couldn't see it in yourself. To your grandmother, to your mother, to your mentor, to your father, to your family members, to your friends. friends, to the people that looked to you and were inspired and were encouraged and were motivated. You had overcame so much. And by doing that, they gave so many other people strength. So I don't want you to deal with the disappointment of thinking that you disappointed them because your dream has left. I can't change it because it was about to happen. And even if I could, I wouldn't.
Would you welcome Mr. Inky Johnson?
Good evening.
Good evening.
You know, first and foremost, I hope you all don't mind me coming off the stage. I'm an up close and personal type of guy. But first, I want to express my gratitude, you know, to Joey, to Mark, to Wes, you know, just for putting the plan in action, all of the sponsors. Thank you guys so much, you know, for thinking enough of me and bringing me up to Rochester and putting me in the school system. That means just as much to me as I think it does to them. You know, and I was telling everybody earlier, I'm very familiar with Rochester because I had my second major surgery at the Mayo Clinic. And I spent about a 4-year stretch from 2006 until 2010, you know, just going back and forth for different appointments, getting different equipment for my arm. And toward the latter part, you know, of 2010, we just used to come up and we would go see the docs and we would rent a car and drive over to the Mall of America and hang out until they caught on and they cut off the trips, right? But, you know, real quick, I'm a person, I enjoy life, right? In every aspect of it. You know, what some may consider to be ups, downs, opposition, adversity, trials and tribulation, I enjoy every single bit of life, and I try my best to be fully present in the moment because I understand the present is the only thing that we really have because tomorrow is not promised, yesterday is already gone. So every moment that I show up in, I try to be fully present and appreciate it for what it is. And I truly believe everything we face and everything we go through, in it lies a lesson and a blessing. And so it's my responsibility to try and extract that. But before I get started, by show of hands, have anybody in here ever been through something that you just didn't understand? About everybody, right? Would anybody mind sharing with me your perspective on it, or how you viewed it, or how did it make you feel? Just two people, if you don't mind. Yes, sir.
I was born to a mom who's paralyzed, and there was a lot of hardships that came with it. And so growing up, there was a lot of dysfunction in my family, and for a long time it affected me, and I always had the question of why? What is the reason? I think I'm starting to get a clearer picture of that now, but for a long time it was a thorn inside.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that. Can we give him a hand? Can I get one more person? Yes, sir.
My wife went to a rooftop accident.
Thank you. I'm giving my answer. You know, the reason I asked that question is earlier at one of the high schools, a kid came up to me after everybody left. And he came up to me and he said, what do you think about paper, scissors, rock? I was like, the game? Paper, scissors, rock? He's like, yeah, what do you think about it? I was like, you'll probably beat me because I don't play it much. He's like, no, but what do you think about it? And I said, you know, explain to me, you know, where you're going with this. Explain your angle with it. He was like, you know, the correlation about life. He said, it just came to me, paper, scissors, rock. And I said, well, I think it's a game of chances. right? And I said, I think also it's a game of uncertainty. And I said, ultimately, you know, you're probably not going to get the result that you want. I said, but I think when we think about the game of paper, scissors, rock, the uncertainty that's attached to it, do you have the courage to accept what you don't understand? And still go at life in a certain way and give everything you got to every aspect of it. Even if I don't understand this thing that's happening to me and that I'm going through right now, I'm still giving everything I got and I'm still walking and living life at the level that I know I can live it at, trusting in myself and having faith that whatever manifests, I will have the courage to accept it, and sooner than later, it'll all make sense. Meaning, when we go through things in life, and sometimes as hard as it may be, and the pain and the discomfort and the uncertainty that it brings, we almost always get to a point in time where we look back and we're either thankful for it, or we say, man, that really hurt, but if I didn't go through that, I probably wouldn't be the individual that I am right now today. And the perspective is somewhat different. I was telling the kids earlier, I said, you know, I've been afforded some things in my life that shifted my perspective earlier. And I said, so I'm almost always, when I approach a person, I approach them a certain type of way with a certain level of compassion, with a certain level of peace, and with a certain level of love, because I understand everybody I meet is fighting a battle that I know nothing about. And so we go through things in life, and people are great actors. People are good at putting the mask up, people are smiling, people are acting, and they can be going through some real stuff at home, but you'll never know it, because when you meet them, they give you a certain type of energy, they give you a certain type of passion, they give you a certain type of love. And so how can we live our lives that when something happens that we don't understand, that we face it, we embrace it, and we step back and we try to use it to add value to every individual's life that we come in contact with and every environment that we go into. And so everybody that I come across, I try to leave them a little bit better. I know I can't change the world. I know I can't save the world. But the people that come across my path, they look at me and they look at me a certain type of way. And I know it. And it used to bother me. Like a long time ago when my injury first happened, I had bad atrophy, as you can see. I went from bench pressing 325 pounds. Now, I've never been a big guy, but I had a little tone to me back when I played ball. I had a couple of muscles on me. And so when my injury happened and I had all this surgery, I showed up at the mall. And people were used to seeing me one way. When I played football, they were used to seeing a little guy, a little bit of yoked up, you know, look a little bit like a Greek god, a little bit, but you know, I'm joking. I'm joking. I've always been a little tiny guy, right? But when they would see me out and walking, they would look like, you know, so that guy's arm. Like something's not right. But when I approach them and I have a certain type of energy, and if they ask me a question about what happened and I explain it to them, and now they're curious to how can you still smile and still laugh and that happened to you? That's what made that video happen. That's how people around the world are starting to figure out who I am. I was telling Joe and the guys last night, they said, man, how long have you been speaking? I said, I've been speaking for 10 years. Nobody ever knew. Because I was just under the radar, and I considered it to be my purpose and my mission, and the way it happened was so organic and authentic. I just got into it, and I just started serving. I just felt as if this was the thing that I was supposed to do after football. I fell in love with it, and I was just going under the radar. I wasn't promoting or nothing like that, but one day I got a call, and there was a producer from ESPN. Man, I saw the videos, I saw everything, man, it jolted me emotionally. It was great. He said, but I got a question for you. I said, what is it? He said, is this Inky Johnson? I said, yeah, man, last time I checked, I'm Inky Johnson. He said, is this the same Inky Johnson that said, if you could change your injury and what happened to you, you wouldn't change it? I said, absolutely. And so what happened to me, I had a brachial plexus avulsion, and I ruptured my subclavian artery in my chest. And so the brachial plexus avulsion is the nerve roots that go into your spine. They control your shoulder, your arm, and your hand. And so when I went to tackle the guy, his helmet hit me between my shoulder and my neck. It sent my neck one way and it sent my shoulder the opposite way. It ruptured an artery in my chest and it tore the nerves away from my spine and I almost lost my life. And so they had to rush me, take the main vein from my left leg, plug it into my chest in order to save my life. My career ended and I was left with a paralyzed right arm and hand overnight. And I said, yes, sir, I wouldn't change it even if I could. He said, it's my understanding that the game of football meant a lot to you and your family, and they were banking on you making it to the NFL so you could really help them. I said, yes, sir. He said, I'm coming to see you. I said, come on, I'm in Atlanta. He said, no, I want to see you in Neyland Stadium on the exact yard line where your life changed. And so in that clip, what you're seeing is me standing on the exact yard line where I made the tackle that changed my life, but the only thing that's not present is the guy that I hit. And I'm talking to my younger self, and I'm telling my younger self, yeah, man, I know you may not get this right now, but the reason I won't stop it, it really has nothing to do with you, but everything that's going to happen as a result in the lives of other people by what happened to you. The ESPN producer couldn't understand my perspective. He couldn't understand how I had the courage to accept what I didn't understand, even though it brought me a certain level of pain, even though I had been working for something my whole life, and not only me working for it, had a group of people that came into my life to help shape and mold me into the individual that I now am. How can you accept that? Because I know it's certain levels of pain that's attached to a certain level of disappointment and depression. And people ask me all the time, well, did you get depressed? And I said, man, the funny thing, I never got depressed. I said I had a certain level of disappointment because I thought me making it to the NFL was going to be everybody that helped me when I made it. I thought they were going to be like, yeah, man, he made it to the NFL. That's why I helped this kid. But that was nobody's outlook. Everybody just wanted to see me become a better person. Everybody just wanted to see me get out of my circumstances and do something positive. Everybody just wanted to see me contribute something back to the world and do what they once did for me. Everybody just wanted to see me pay it forward with the way that I live my life. And so the disappointment now, once I got that out of the way and understood what they expected of me, it wasn't football. They expected me just to be a great human being and go out and add value to the lives of people that I come in contact with and the places and environments that I go into. I was on fire. It was like I got infinitely stronger by something that should have hurt me and taken me out. It made me stronger. It fueled my fire. And so when I went back to school and I went back to practice with my teammates, my trainers came in one day, and after my surgery at Mayo, they said, Inky, go back to Atlanta, take some time off. I said, take some time off for what? They said, man, you just went through trauma, extreme trauma, not only physically. They said, you just went through trauma, like you lost your dream, man. I said, no, I'm not going home. They said, take a break, take some time off. I said, I'm not taking a break and taking time off. I said, I made a vow to something that was a lot greater than myself. They said, what do you mean by that? I said, I made a vow to a lot of people that I will finish what I start. And the greatest lesson I've ever received from my mother, and my mother didn't have much education. She had me at 16 years old. She took me back to a two-bedroom home with 14 people, sleeping on the floor with roaches and rats. She worked a double shift at Wendy's. She didn't have much education, but the one valuable lesson that she gave me when I was younger, she said, son, I'm not going to let you go through life being a coward. And I said, what do you mean by that? I'm not going to let you start and stop. Meaning everything you start, even if you get in the process of it and you don't like it, whether you don't like a coach, you don't like a person, you don't like the process, you're not checking out. You're going to finish it because in life, it's more important about who you become than what you acquire. And so when they told me to go home, I said, I'm not going home. I'm finishing what I start. When I stepped on this campus, I had a goal other than the game of football. I was the first one in my family to go to college, and I'm going to complete that. It didn't give me the right to stop just because an injury happened. It didn't give me the right to stop just because my right arm and hand was now out of commission, and I was right hand dominant my whole life. It didn't give me the right to stop because I had to learn how to walk all over again. It didn't give me the right to stop because I had to go into my apartment, and my roommates had to help me take a bath because I got cut 6 times down my left thigh, one across the left side of my neck, one across the right side, twice through my right pec. They cut it out. They cut me from the armpit to the bottom of my hand, 350 staples in my body. They bandaged me from my neck to my knee. It still didn't give me the right. Did I understand it? No. Was I spitting revelation right when it happened? No. Was I going out to people and say, man, I know why I got this arm? No. They would say, Inky, what? I don't know. What are you going to do? Keep pressing forward. And by pressing forward, I'm sure a plan will be revealed and something will manifest because of it. But I understand if I don't stop and I keep pressing forward every single day, I'll get a little bit stronger. And just by learning how to walk again every single day, I'll get a little bit stronger. Every trip I took up to the Mayo, they gave me a machine. They took me through different routines. I got a little bit stronger. And the reason I got a little bit stronger is because I didn't make an excuse. I didn't justify the situation. And I didn't quit. And I didn't stop. And I didn't surrender to something that I didn't understand. That was the main reason I asked the question, because I'm always intrigued by why do people stop, quit, and make excuses and just check out? And I know life is tough, and I know we get hit with some things sometimes that we just don't understand and we can't fathom, but I'm always intrigued by if somebody is invested in something and somebody is going hard at something and somebody is living life on a certain level, how do we get to the point as people when we just say, man, you know what? I quit. I'm out. And a group of Navy SEALs came to see me once after my first surgery. And they was in there and they gave me a coin, and across the coin had the words commitment. And they were talking to me about this thing called Hell Week. I said, Hell Week? They said, yeah, Hell Week breaks the baddest of the bad, man. They said, that's why we train. You know, it's kind of a build up to Hell Week. Then when they get to Hell Week, it pretty much separates the men from the boys. It separates the people that, you know, they talk the good game, but we really see if they really want it when we face Hell Week, because during Hell Week, you got to tap out and you got to surrender. And they said it's guys that physically, they look the part, right? It's guys that, you know the game. They've been doing it. They've been training. It's a buildup. They've been killing it. It's just like in the world, right? It's people that are brilliant, people that are smart, people that are well-connected, people that come from, you know, great communities, great families. Then we've all seen it, a brilliant person that faces adversity and they can't fight themselves out of a paper bag. What is that? And I asked him, I said, okay, in Hell Week, I understand the part you're speaking of that somebody, you know, has to quit and surrender. I said, but it also has to be some people that make it. And I said, how do the ones that make it make it? I said, what separates them? Like, it has to be a factor. And they said, the guys that make it, they got this thing called the power of other. It's a book by Henry Cloud. He wrote about it. They said the power of other is the guys that make it, you know, some of the guys that's already made it to shore when they're training, and the guys get ready to surrender, and the guys get ready to quit, and the guys get ready to check out. They said just by looking in the eyes of the guys, the other guys that they train with. They said just by looking in the eyes of the other guys that they made accountability vows to, just by looking in the eyes of the other guys that they went to war with, they bled, they sweated, and they cried. But just by looking at the eyes of the other guys, the power of other, when they get ready to surrender and when they get ready to quit, they come up out of the water and they make it. And they said the other guys that surrender, those guys make excuses and they try to justify everything, but they face a situation that they don't understand. But not only do they not understand it, the situation becomes tougher than them. And so when they were the Navy SEALs, they were the toughest and the baddest of the bad. They come in contact, even still, with a situation that's a lot tougher than them. And some guys make it and some guys don't. It's the same thing with life. People that are brilliant, people that are smart, people that are tough, people that are doing well. I always tell people, the 75% of life is great. It's beautiful. It's rich. It's filled with great moments, family, friends. We go to different places. I said, but it's that 25% of life that we don't expect. And something comes and something hit us. We're like, man, where did that come from? It's that 25% when one day we're standing on top of the world, everything is going great, then tomorrow the world is on top of us, that 25%. And the power of other, I think, is when we live life with a purpose that's a lot greater than ourselves. I think the power of other, when we get up and we think about our children or our spouses or our friends or our family members, the people that we live our lives for, and I tell kids all the time, I say, no matter how high you rise in life, no matter how successful you become, the thing that we can never forget, in everybody's life, there were people that played a part in shaping and molding us into the individuals that we become. In every single life, every single day, it's two words that I think about every day of my life, every day I wake up. It's two words, honor and it's legacy. And it's honor and it's legacy because every day of my life, I wake up and I want to honor the people that have paved the way for me, and I want to leave a legacy for the generation that's coming behind me. I'm very concerned with the plight of young people in our world. And the reason I do this and the reason I'm so passionate about it is because at a certain point in my life, I wanted to go to the NFL, had dreams, goals, and aspirations, but my circumstances and my environment, it was people getting murdered, people getting robbed, I got robbed, things happened every single day, so much so to the point to where I had the goal and the dream, I was focused, I was driven, but I didn't know if my circumstances was going to let me make it. Until a coach came down the street one night, and it was almost like he was a guardian angel. And I love to tell the story about him because he's an amazing soul. He's my guy. And we're playing tackle football in the street, bloody, getting after it, crack back and rolling guys up, bloody, and a blue pickup truck comes down the street and parks on the sidewalk. And out of it gets the first white guy I ever saw in my life, in real life, in my neighborhood, right slap dab, my guy. Gets out of the truck, walks up in the middle of the game, just like this. He's like, man, do y'all kids want to play football on grass? Y'all want to play organized ball? I'm like, yeah, man, I would love that. I said, go to the house and get your guardian. I ran in the house. My uncle J.J. was there by marriage. And I said, hey, uncle, man, there's a guy outside. He asked me if I could play organized sports. Will you please come and talk to him? Uncle, sure. Uncle comes outside. The coach said, listen, I don't even supposed to be over here. So I brought a kid home up the street, rolled down and see these kids playing tackle football on the street. They're bloody. He said, I run a little league across town. I think y'all bring them out. Y'all can get them signed up. It'd be a great opportunity for them. Uncle said, sir, we greatly appreciate you extending the invitation. He said, but I hate to inform you. We just don't have the money. And I'm standing in front of him because I really want to play. And he said, his mother, she's working double shift at Wendy's right now. She definitely doesn't have the money. And that coach looked back at him and said, I tell you what, He said, y'all bring him to the park tomorrow? He said, not only will I sign him up, I'll sign the other three up as well. And the other three were my three little cousins. They brought us to the park the next day. He signed all of us up. You know, my family, the first ones I went to college, me and my three little cousins that was in that street that coach signed up when he didn't have to. But the second person I saw in the hospital when I had to get my life saved from surgery, when I opened my eyes, the second person I saw was that coach that met me in the street when I was 7 years old, crying on my mother's shoulder. Just an amazing soul. And coming from where I came from, we didn't see people like that. And one night he took me home, and I'll never forget, I stood on the curb in front of my house. And I said, man, why do you do what you do? Like, why do you take kids home? Why do you pay for kids to be involved in things? Because he just didn't do it for me. He did it for just about every kid that he saw. Like, he was just one of these guys, great guys, right? Bought me drawers and socks on Christmas when I was 7 years old, 30 years old. God still buys me drawers and socks. I don't even need it, right? And this is my guy, right? I love him to death. I'll fight a bear for him, right? But I asked him one day, I said, man, why do you do it? Like, why do you live life that way? There's no catch-22. You don't do things, you know, for ego and all this. Like, why do you do it? He said, son, I'm going to tell you something, and I don't want you to ever forget it. He said, as long as you make sure that somebody else's life is okay, he said, the Creator will always make sure that your life is okay. He said, at a certain point, Inc., like, you're only going to get so far just doing things just for your personal gain. Like, no matter how great you may be, you know, you're going to do things, you're going to go into situations trying to figure out how can it benefit you, but there comes a point in time where life dishes you something, and if you don't have a greater purpose for why you live your life and why you do what you do, when life dishes you something that's a lot tougher than you, it's a great chance that can define your life, and that can make you stop and quit. And so early on, I tapped into it, and I said, man, I don't even know what I'm doing, but I do know I want to live my life for the people that have helped me become the individual that I am and made sacrifices for me, even when they didn't have to. And so on September 9, 2006, 10 years ago, when I almost lost my life and I was at the hospital, and by the grace of God, I made it through that. I made it through it, and my perspective was totally different. You know, people may have thought I got in the hospital, and I was like, man, I'm not going to make it to the NFL. People might have thought, man, I thought about, man, I'm not going to be able to play Alabama next week. I'm not going to be able to play Florida. Like, I'm not going to be able to play in another game. You know, that wasn't the question, strangely enough. I thought about, like, what my life would represent. You know, there's a quote that says, when do a person really start to live when a person has encountered death? And I said, Inc., is this the only thing that your life is going to be about? Like, I got a 5-year-old son, 6-year-old daughter, me and my wife, you know, married. Beautiful marriage. Me and my wife been on and off ever since we were in the 5th grade. My rock knows me like the back of her hand, right? But she told me a long time ago, 8th grade, she told me we're going to be married one day. And we are. But I thought about it. I said, man, is this the only thing that you want somebody one day when you're having a family gathering and somebody comes up to your kids and they say, man, I remember your father. He's a great athlete. He dunked the basketball. I remember watching him intercept the football, watching him play baseball. Is that the only thing they're going to speak to him about? Or is your life going to have some substance and some value to? Like, will somebody be able to point to something that you've contributed to and added value to that can impact your children in such a way to make them want to move and get up and live their lives a certain type of way? And so when I got out of the hospital, strangely enough, I thought I was driven before, I thought I was committed before, I thought I was dedicated before. But man, when I got out of that hospital, man, I had a drive that I didn't know I had. I tapped into a place that I didn't know I possessed. Like, I went at things totally different. And my perspective, it was as if somebody pulled the shades up and said, now you see life for what it's really worth. Now you see people for who they really are. Now you can appreciate the small and the rich moments of life. Now every single day you go at it a certain way, and it's easy to appreciate the simple and the small things. I tell people all the time, my life is different. I got a paralyzed right arm and hand, and this is a lot of people, they got it 10 times worse than me. But what this paralyzed right arm and hand has done for me is made me slow down. Whereas when I used to get up, I could just get dressed, put my feet in my shoes, go about my business. Now when I get up, I gotta grab my toothbrush, I gotta put it between my teeth, I gotta balance it with my teeth, gotta grab my toothpaste, I put my toothpaste on it. I gotta make sure all of my shoes are already tied because I can't tie them with one hand. Like, there's certain things I have to prepare mentally because I know every single day I'm gonna encounter something that I just can't do, and I have to be willing to accept that and keep going forward and not get discouraged. Whereas sometimes I used to just get up, going about my business, handle it, going about it, meet people, hey man, how you doing? Keep it moving. Now when I meet people, it's really, hey, how you doing? Life okay? Wife okay? Family okay? All right, man, I love you. Keep trucking. It slowed me down and made me appreciate life for what it really is. Because we can get going and going and going and going and going, and then something comes and it slows us down that we didn't expect. And we're like, man, why me? Like, why did this have to happen to me? Life was going great, everything was going good, why me? But what happens when we slow down as the students of life, when things happen, we step back, we say, okay, God, what's your plan for this moment? Where's the lesson in this moment? Where's the blessing in this moment? Even though it may be an ugly situation, where's the blessing in it that I can extract and apply to other areas of my life? Now when I can no longer play the game of football, my NFL career was gone. Now I step back and I looked at the process and I said, yeah, the product is gone. The product was to make it to the NFL, go on so I can add value to my community, give back to my family, help them, but the product is gone. I can no longer play. But I can still extract things from the process of it. I can still extract the work ethic. I can still extract the dedication. I can still extract the commitment and apply it to other areas of my life to make me one day a great father, to make me one day a great husband, to make me one day a great citizen. Now I can still go at my life the same way. I just can't play the game of football. My arm and my hand is paralyzed. My heart isn't. My mentality isn't. My drive isn't. My dedication isn't. The way I go about things, it isn't paralyzed. My arm and hand is just paralyzed. But I didn't let the moment rob me of my joy. I didn't let the moment rob me of my peace. I didn't let the moment rob me of my happiness. And life is robbing people every single day. You think people get robbed on the south side of Chicago, life is robbing people. Think people get robbed on the east side of Atlanta, life is robbing people every single day with uncertainty. That's why I say, anybody face uncertainty? Everybody, uncertain. Man, I'm uncertain about this. And what's attached to uncertainty is worry. And it says it in a good book, who of you by worrying can add one single hour to your life? But what worrying is a down payment on a problem that you may never have. We worry about things that may never even happen. Instead of saying, man, no, I'm going to be fully present in this moment because this is really the only moment that I got. So I'm going to give everything I got to it. Today is the only day that I'm sure of. So I'm going to give everything I got to it. These people that are around me, I'm going to love them until I can love them no more. The things that I come in contact with, I'm going to embrace it, try my best to understand it. Even if I don't understand it, I'm going to have the courage to accept it for what it is and try to add value to every person's life that I come in contact with and every environment that I go into. I'll never forget, I was reading a story about two guys. They were placed in an institution, and they were terminally ill. They placed them in this institution to die, and they had the same nurse, and they put these guys in a room, and these guys were on two opposite sides of the room. They had a nurse that would come in, and the nurse would feed them and give them something to drink every single day. And so these guys, they were sitting there, and they would do their thing. And so one of the guys, the catch was, he had a bed that was by the window. So every day, the nurse would come in, she would feed him, give him something to drink. So the guy with the bed by the window, his buddy would always say, hey man, tell me what you see out that window. Guy would lift himself up, say, man, I see a beautiful skyline. Say, man, I see beautiful kids running, playing, beautiful couples, walking, holding hands, beautiful flowers. And this guy would say, man, thank you so much, man. So one day the nurse came in and she had a food and had the water, and the guy with the bed by the window had died. And so she goes to prep him, and as she's taking him out, the guy on the opposite side said, hey, nurse. He said, what is it? He said, can you do me a favor? I said, yeah, what is it? He said, whenever you put my guy wherever you got to put him, can you please come back and can you move my bed by the window? I want the opportunity to lift myself up and see what my guy used to tell me about. That really helped me in my situation. He said, sure. But she came back the next day. She rolled his bed by the window. He's sitting there. She gave him something to eat, gave him a little bit of water. He ate, he drank. He got the strength. He lifted himself up, looked out of the window, and the only thing he saw was a brick wall. The nurse. The nurse came running in. What is it? He said, why is there a brick wall there? He said, can we please get that wall removed? You know, my guy used to tell me about this beautiful skyline. And my guy told me about these beautiful kids running, playing, beautiful couples, walking, holding hands, beautiful flowers. It really helped me in my situation. Can we please get that wall removed? And the nurse looked back at him. She said, you didn't know? He said, no what? She said, he was blind. He said he couldn't have seen that even if he wanted to. He said, you didn't even know. Every day he lifted himself up and looked out at it. Every day he did that to bring you joy. Every day he did that to bring you peace. Every day he did that because he knew it brought happiness to you. He had his own situation going, and then you had a blind guy that lifted himself up, looked out of the window and painted a picture that he couldn't even see simply because he knew it brought his counterpart joy. And so I have to pose the question today, with the things that we're a part of and the things that we do, like why do we do it and where is it taking us? Like, what's the GPS on our life? You know, we put the GPS and the address in. Like, what's the GPS on our life with the decisions and the choices we're making every single day? Because we all know at the end of the day, when it's all said and done, the only thing that really matters is who we become and what we give back to life. That's it. It's nothing superficial, nothing materialistic. It's who we become as individuals. It's about what we give back to life. What one day can our kids be proud of? They can look to and say, man, you know what? My father was a part of that. My mother was a part of that. They contributed to that. That's that legacy. I want to keep that going for our family. What's that thing that one day people will speak about you and what you represented and the way you live your life and how you picked them up? Like me and my wife, we went downtown. We worked with homeless all the time. And I'm going to be honest, we went into the situation, and I was thinking to myself, though, man, I said, you know, people that are homeless, they're just irresponsible. That's what I'm thinking, going into it, they're just irresponsible. Until you get to the shelter, and you meet some people, and you're sitting there, and you're serving them dinner, and you take some clothing to their closet, and you send everybody out a story. And it's a mother there with her daughter, and she says, you know, I'm running from abuse. It's the only place that I could go, and he won't find me. Our man is in there, and he's eating, and he's like, hey, man, what's up, man? How you doing? You know, what's going on? What's your story? Man, lost my family in a fight. Lost everything we had. The shelter took me in. Let me get back on my feet. We started feeding them, taking clothing to their closets, taking kids down, letting them serve them, and doing different things with them. But what happened after the first one was incredible. Like, I got my phone now, my phone is blowing up because people know every year around this time in Atlanta, we get a group of people, we go down to the shelter, we have game nights, we have a good time, so everybody, every year, they hit me up, Inky, we're going to the shelter. People that are introverts, people that don't like being around people, people that are selfish, Inky, we're going to the shelter. And after the first one, you know, I can see everybody serving, we're having fun, people are doing, people's hairs, we're playing games. And we get outside in the parking lot, and we're taking buckets of chicken back to the car. You know, we're taking juices and everything. But you could tell everybody's kind of in a trance. Like, everybody's walking like, man, what just happened? And I said, all right, man, let's circle it up. Let's pray, you know, and take it home. And we lock up hands. And I got my head down and say, everybody bow your heads. And I look up. Everybody in the circle is crying. And I said, pick your heads up for a moment. I said, what's that? I said, what are you talking about? I said, what's that? I'm crying too. I don't know how to stop it. I'm like, what's that? It's like, man, the experience is so rich. It's like moving into it without preconceived notions about people. It's like it wasn't that at all. Like, I challenge you as people to go through this one day if you could and not judge anybody. Like, not judge the situation, not judge the person. Not just an environment, just appreciate life and what it throws at you, embrace it, go with the flow of life, and just enjoy it for what it is. I challenge you one single day to wake up and not judge anything. People went into a preconceived notion of judging. I did myself. And when I left the next day, I said, you know what? I'm just going to appreciate life, what it is, how it unfolds. I'm going to embrace it. I'm going to try to use it. I'm not judging anything. That's why my spirit is so free. Like, I got a free spirit. When I meet people, it's hard for me to even be mad at people. When they do something to me, I can't contain that in my spirit because of the level of life that I want to live and the things that I want to do. So when you do something to me, I'll still hug you and tell you I love you, and you may not even understand it. But I can't let that contain my spirit and take up space in my life because I know it may be a kid that I'll come in contact with. They may want to say, hey, what's up? Ask me some questions. If I'm walking around mad, I might miss that blessing, and he might miss that blessing. And so I can't let it contain me when I get home to my 5-year-old son, my 6-year-old daughter. I can't be mad at anyone. I can't be mad at somebody in the world and get home to my wife and hug her with my one arm, kiss her and tell her I love her and tell her let's be present in the moment for what it is. I can't live my life that way. And so every single day, the only thing I try to do is be a better version of myself. That's it. I'm not judging anybody. I'm not putting my life up to anybody. Every single day, I'm trying to be a better father. Every single day, I'm trying to be a better husband. Every single day, I'm trying to be a better citizen. Every single day, I'm just trying to contribute to the world in ways that I never imagined and try to add value to every person's life that I come in contact with and every environment that I go into. That's it. And I'm incredibly thankful for the vehicle of football because I think it's shaped and molded me into the individual that I now am. I challenge you to go through life and not judge a thing. Appreciate it for what it is. I tell people all the time, man, life is stuff. Life is so beautiful and rich if your perspective can find it. Our perspective can be our prison, or our perspective can be our passport. And it can take us wherever we want to go. But it's up to us. Amen. Life is never about what happens to us. It's about how we respond to it. And the thing that we can never do is people. No matter how talented, how brilliant, how sweet, how great, how well connected that we are, the thing that we can never do as people is settle for less than we can do, settle for less than we can be, or settle for less than we can give. Because at the end of the day, it's really two things that matter. Who we became and what we gave back to life. That's it. That's my time. God bless you. Thank you. Q&A, if you have any questions, whether it's about injury, football, life, anything, my life's an open book. Whatever you would like to ask, please feel free.
Catherine, tell me, what do you say to someone that you meet who has had some setback and is hopeless and afraid?
Absolutely. I would say, you know, people are so paralyzed by fear that it stops them in their tracks and it controls their life. And so the thing that I would share with them is use fear and don't let it use you. You know, because we all come in contact with things that we don't understand and it hurts. And not to minimize the situation ever, because we face real things in this world. But don't let it paralyze you. Don't let it rob you. Use it and don't let it use you. A lot of people, they have two types of fears. There's people that are fearful about what's gonna happen, and there's people that are fearful about, if I don't execute and do what I'm supposed to do, what type of life will my family have? Like, I guarantee you, some people in this room right now that are extremely overachievers, simply out of fear. Because they faced a certain situation when they were younger, and like, man, I don't ever wanna go through that. I don't want my family to go through that. So every single day I'm gonna get up, and I'm gonna crush it, and it's driven by fear. Then there's people that get up and they're fearful about what life may bring. There's people that get up and they're fearful about achieving. So use fear and don't let it use you.
I'll jump in right here. You expressed that Century, you talked about your spirituality and faith. Can you expound on that for a second?
Absolutely. Faith is very important to me. I didn't share this with the kids earlier, but you know, as I think back on it, I was always in the church, but I started getting discipled spiritually, like personal, one-on-one spiritual development, going deep. When I went to college, we had a guy by the name of James Mitchell. He's now an advisor at Duke University. But he started working with me and about three other guys, and you know, we put in much work on that side, just as much as we put in with football, and so we'd be in spiritual development before we went to weight training. And we made sacrifices and did all these things, and what it did for me was he made trips up to the Mayo with me every year for 4 years straight. But what it did for me, it gave me a perspective on my injury happened. And to be honest with you, I don't think, if I didn't have that spiritual development for those 3 years prior to my injury, and I think it was preparation, now looking back on it, but if I didn't have it, I don't think my perspective would have been the same. But because of that hard 3 years of spiritual development, when my injury happened, my perspective was a little bit different, and I was rooted enough in my spiritual walk that I could get somewhat of an understanding, not a clear understanding, but somewhat of an understanding, and accept it and embrace it, you know, and walk forward and press forward. You know, forgetting those things which are behind me, pressing forward to the things which are before me, right? I had the courage to press forward. But my spiritual development is very, very important with me. I live a holistic life. You know, I believe you gotta be in shape mentally, physically, and spiritually. You know, you have people that are in shape physically and mentally, spiritually, they're out of whack. You know, I believe in being in shape in all three.
I got a question for you. I'll bring one up. Hopefully somebody else has got another one too. What's your, tell us about your relationship with your mother and grandmother.
My grandmother, I just lost her probably about a month ago. And the person that's responsible for, you know, a big part of who I am. Person that made me want to do things in life, made me want to make her proud. The person that possessed the level of faith that made me want to become a better man. My mother, honor my mother, will never embarrass her, love my mother to death. She sacrificed a lot for me. She had me at 16. Her and my father, man, it used to be rough times because here you had a mother at 16 that had a son. And my father at the time, my father was 17. And my father had just lost his mother. And I didn't learn this until later on, but my father had just lost his mother. And like a month later, my mother approached him like, hey, I'm pregnant with your son. And my father was lost and he was running, right? Because he was scared. He was running out of fear. And so my mother and my father, they couldn't even be around each other. So I was a four sport athlete. So I'd be getting awards in Atlanta. And I couldn't see my father. And if my mother was in the room, if my father, he would just come by, hey, what's up? He would keep it moving. And for the first time in my life, what my injury did, the reason I'm so thankful for it is because it's things that have happened in my life that a lot of people don't even see. And the reason I told that producer I would never change it was because of moments like this, Joe. When my injury happened, my mother and father, keep in mind, my whole life, my mother and my father pretty much despised each other. Like, my mother didn't care 2 cents about him, and he was just scared. Because every time he came close, she was like a ticket, she'll go off. You coward, you. He tried to stay as far away from her as he could, right? And she had a right to be mad, right? And so for the first time when my injury happened, I was in the hospital after my first surgery. I'll never forget it. My father was at the game, of course. My mother was there. And I'm lying in my bed. And at this time, they didn't know what was about to happen. They didn't know if I was going to survive. They didn't know they was going to have to cut my arm off. They didn't know what was about to happen. You just got people running around and scared. And so I'm in the room, and I'm lying there in my hospital bed. And I got my eyes closed. And my father is lying on the floor on his back. He's looking up at the ceiling. My mother is sitting on a little cot. So they think I'm asleep. And I hear my father say on the floor, he said, Ruby, I'm sorry. He said, you did a great job with ink. He said, I never had the courage to say that. And I'm sitting there, there's tears rolling down my mother's face. Because they didn't know if I was going to live, if I was going to die. And ever since that point, we still got a little bit of dysfunction, but it got a whole lot better, if you know what I mean. It's moments like that, man, that my mother and my grandmother means the world to me, and my father, even though he wasn't who he should have been in my earlier life, I'm still thankful, I still respect him as my father in the latter part of my life.
I really don't need microphones. I'm wondering, do you have any tips for people to try to stay in positive light? I really feel like it's rejuvenating to listen to you and would love to keep that positivity, but sometimes I feel like going through everyday life, like you said, life robs people. I do feel like sometimes it's easy to slip back into that. Do you have any tips?
I would say laugh. Sometimes you just gotta laugh at life. I'm serious. Because life will throw you something so hard, you gotta laugh to keep from crying. Right? But most importantly, every day you get up, I think when things happen, like life, the way I view life is like we're only gonna be here in the grand scheme for a short period of time. In the grand scheme. Like, I was thinking about this a couple of weeks ago when I lost my grandmother. My grandmother, man, that tore me up. Like, it felt like I was carrying around weights on my shoulder. Life got heavy, right? And I used to shake some things, but I couldn't shake this. Like, I lost my grandmother, and I just had seen her a day prior to losing her. I was in the hospital. We were laughing. We were cracking jokes. She was telling me to get her out of here. And the next day, I get a call. My grandmother's checked out, and I'm walking around this heavy, man. And after we buried her and everything, and a couple of weeks later, you know, we're sitting at her house, everybody's laughing, cracking jokes. And I'm paying attention, and I'm like, how did everybody just get through it and get over it that quick. And really, everybody was just laughing to keep from crying because it was so heavy and so tough. But every single day, we have to realize, like, life is short. That's why I said I can't walk around mad. Like, I can't walk around, like, with resentment. I can't walk around like that. I can't walk around tense and just having things. Like, I can't walk around like that because I don't know when my last day is coming. Like, just the fact, I tell some kids, just the fact that you don't know your death date should be enough reason to get up and execute and do what you got to do. Just the fact, we don't know. I don't know when I'm checking out. So every single day that I'm blessed with, I'm going to give everything I got to. So sometimes we just got to laugh and keep crying, laugh at life. Smack it up a little bit, smack it around, laugh at it. So you dish me something hard because you're not giving me down, I'm going to laugh at you.
If you didn't get the injury, what would you do?
I would like to think if I didn't get the injury, I would probably be playing in the NFL a little bit on Sunday, you know. A little bit, you know. But you know, who's to say, man? You know, I'm thankful for what I'm doing. To be honest with you, I don't think if I went to the NFL that I would be able to have the impact that I have on a lot of people now. You know, not that I wouldn't serve or go out and speak, because I would, but I'm a person that when I do something, I do. So when I played football, I would just train and work out like crazy and play. And like right now when I serve like crazy. And so the reason I say that is because I just think I would have just been fully present. But I would like to say that I'll be making some plays on a Sunday somewhere.
Nikki, I've got a question. We certainly seem to be a divided country, and I don't think it's as divided as it's made out to be, but maybe a person like you can give some of us a perspective. You know, I want to thank you for hosting this, for one thing, but not all of us have the ability to bring all these people together and bring you to Rochester, but what can we do on an individual basis every day when we get up and go out there? What can we do to help bring this country back together?
Absolutely. I think the first thing we got to do is love. You know, it starts with love. It starts with compassion. And, you know, being willing to put our eyeballs in someone else's skull. You know, and what I mean by that is, like, I use the comparison between a turtle and a giraffe, right? And I say the turtle and the giraffe, they see life in two different levels. But there's nothing wrong with either perspective. The giraffe just has the neck and he's looking up and out, and the turtle is down and he's looking down and he's doing his thing, but it's nothing wrong with either perspective. And sometimes when we love people for who they are, and this applies to every area of life, even with, you know, people that have things going on, whatever the case may be, the thing that my coach did for me, more than anything, he loved me. And it went from him showing up in my neighborhood and people running because they thought he was a cop. Whenever that blue pickup truck came, they were running to the truck. I'm like, oh man, what's up? You can sign my kids up. There were people trying to preload off of them and everything, right? But I think it starts with love and compassion, right? For each other. You know, having a certain level of respect for each other. But ultimately, we have to serve. We have to contribute to something, whether it's the next generation, whether it's a boys and girls club, whether it's some kids, you know, somebody across town. Like, we have to contribute to something that's a lot greater than ourselves. That's why I was so grateful they did this and brought me here, because it shows that they care about the next generation and the school system. And you all just coming out tonight, some of you all with your kids. Like, that's great. That's a step forward. And all we can do is continue to press and do what we can do and hope people get it and hope people understand. But ultimately, when we love people and we show compassion, sometimes we put our eyeballs in other people's skull. I think that's ultimately a great step. Sir.
Did you ever at one point, or still do you still have contact with the man that you hit during the game before the injury?
I haven't talked to him in a while. I spoke to him shortly thereafter my injury. And the thing about Air Force first class university, their coach was great, the administration there was great. But the kid, he actually was from Atlanta. Both of us were Atlanta kids. And I got on the phone with him one day, and poor guy, man, he's crying his eyes out. You know, and all he was saying was, man, I'm sorry. I ruined your career. Like, I knew I didn't have a shot at the NFL. I was like, bro, thank you. And he stopped crying. He's like, thank you? What are you talking about? I said, man, thank you. Because who's to say without that, that hit, that I would view life the way that I do. I said, man, it's not your fault. Like, I believe in life, I believe in destiny, I believe in fate. I believe things are predestined and orchestrated by power that's a lot greater than myself. And so I think, you know, I didn't want him carrying around a burden thinking he ended a person's career. Like, even if it hurt it and I didn't understand it, it wasn't his fault. This is life, things happen. And now we can see the true plan being revealed of what I've been orchestrated to do and ordained to do, and it had nothing to do with him. The hit was just a part of it. It was just a play in script. And so he was great, man. He was very apologetic, but you know, there was nothing to be apologetic about.
Absolutely. Hi, my name's Tom.
Sir.
Inky, thank you for being here and sharing with us. Some very deep thoughts, and, very inspirational. My wife and I moved here from Denver. I have two questions.
Sure.
But first I'd like to tell you, you're quite a motivation. You definitely are a motivator. I'm a member of the Optimist Club here in Rochester. If you get a chance, you'd like to read the Optimist Creed. I see a lot of my fellow Optimist members here. And I'm sure they share the same thing that I do. We appreciate you being here. But I've often wondered about a motivational speaker such as yourself. One of the two questions is, what motivates you more than anything else? What motivates the motivator? And the other question, being from Denver, want to know who your favorite football player is. mine is Von Miller.
Von's a beast. Von's a beast.
Thank you.
I think I'll answer the latter two first. My favorite football player is Eric Berry. Plays for the Kansas City Chiefs, safety, number 29. It's like my little brother. He beat cancer last year. He wears number 29 in honor of me. If you guys ever see the Chiefs play, and he makes a play, and he does this, and he salutes, that's for me. You know, we're very close. But what motivates me is just serving more of what serves life, you know, serving people, serving environments, you know, and the way it happened with me, I never thought I would be doing it. I never said one day I want to travel across the country, share. It just happened. And when it happened, I saw it more as a honor than anything. I guess an honor for me to be in front of people and people would sit down and actually listen, you know, and process and ask me questions. It's an honor for me that people show up in a place and I'm going to speak. It's an honor that people fly me out somewhere and they trust the words that I'm saying. They value it enough that they put me in the school system to their kids and let me share. Like, it's always an honor for me, and I approach it that way every single time. You know, and so everywhere I go, I look at it as a divine appointment and an honor, and that's what motivates me. Knowing I'm doing what I've been put on this earth to do.
Hi, Inky. My sentiment is the same. Thanks for being here, and thanks for being you. I'm curious to know when you were younger, because I know when you talk about fear, how that's a learned feeling, right? What was it like when you were, what, when you felt like when you were scared of the dark when you were younger? You know, things like that that we can help maybe some younger
Absolutely.
Kids
Absolutely.
Not have.
It was like our environment was so different. So anything that they knew we were scared of, it's like they tried to amplify it times 10, right? And so the way I learned how to swim, it wasn't regular swimming lessons. They threw me in the pool and laughed, right? Until I found a way to get to the thing, you know? If I walked past a court, right? And I saw guys, like the reason I got to, you know, pretty decent at sports was I played with people a lot older than me. And so if I would see guys playing and they would be out doing it, and I would be like, man, no, those guys are doing it. And I don't want to, you know, I don't want to go to that. I'll wait. Guys my age, they'll be like, oh, you scared? Get in. Hey, get him. And I'll be walking away bloody, banged up. And so I guess I would say they made me attack it early. And so whatever I was scared of, they made me attack it and face it. Then once I faced it and got in the midst of it, even if I was a little bit scared, but after the fact, I was like, oh, man, that wasn't so bad. Right, when I jump in the pool, I'm scared for my life. I'm thinking I'm about to die. They're laughing at me, and I'm making it to the edge. I'm like, maybe I can dunk back. You know, and so everything is just
I'm gonna ask him something as well. I'm gonna ask him something as well.
Okay. My son, I'm working on that one. Son, and this is a challenge. He thinks it's monsters, and I'm like, where did he get this from? You know, but it's awesome.
Oh,
I got a question for you. Why do you like king size beds?
Oh, man. Yeah. You know, when I was growing up, we used to make pallets on the floor. We sleep on the floor. One night out of the week, we get the opportunity to sleep in a bed. When I was little, it was 2 bedroom home, 14 of us. And so when we got the opportunity to sleep in a bed, it was 6 of us. We 3 at the head, 3 at the head. And so most nights, we slept on the floor. And when I got my scholarship offer from Tennessee, they brought me up on a visit. And, you know, when you visit, they kind of wine and dine you, take you to parties and games and things like that. And I had hopes. So the job of a host, he's just supposed to make you just fall in love with the place. And this guy, he's like, oh man, we're about to have us a big night. And they had already took me to the Marriott first. And so I had my room at the Marriott. He took me to dinner. Then the guy, we come out of dinner, he's like, oh, a big night. About to go to a sorority party. He was like, I don't know if you've ever been to a sorority party, but that's the place. And I'm like, man, if you don't mind, can you take me to my hotel? He's like, what? I mean, I don't know if you've been to a college sorority party, but you need to be seriously considering going to this party. Like, it gets pretty wild. I'm like, nah, you take me to the Marriott. And so we pull up, and he's like, man, are you sick? Like, it's never happened. Like, people always want to go hang out. I'm like, no, man, I'm not sick. Like, I'm in a room, man, with my own bed. It's a king size of bed. I care about no sorority party. I went up in that room, I'll never forget it. I called my boys back in Kirkport, you know, everybody's giving them a speakerphone and all that. I'm like, hey man, listen. I'm hyped too. I'm like, man, you guys gotta go to college. They're like, what? I don't know about that, man. I'm like, man, you get your own king size bed. They're like, we might consider, right? So they put me in a dorm, freaking twin size. Yeah, but just the beauty of life. You know, it's the beauty of life. And, but at king size, it felt good.
One thing in your videos online that I watched a little bit of is you talk about at a young age, your determination thing you did to chase your dream of playing in the NFL. And that determination of going after what you want is something I struggle with my own kids to teach them. Can you talk a little bit about your experiences and how you chased that, how to bring inspiration?
Absolutely. You know, the way I approach things, even until this day, is like the outcome is one thing, and I put it in this thing where I say the process is more important than the product. And the product is pretty much the outcome and people being externally driven and just saying how that's only going to get you so far. Sooner or later, you got to pull from something within. But when I say the process of what we do is more valuable than the product of what we do, what I'm saying is, how can we go at things and we give everything we got to it to when the outcome disappears, the goal disappears, or things don't manifest the way that we thought them would, if we don't get what we want, what we set out to get, things change. We can still look at the process and say, you know what? I can still grab that from it. I can still grab that from it. I can still become a better, a wiser, a stronger individual. And so me running to the fire station, you know, running 2 miles to the fire station, 2 miles back home, yeah, it was about training, but more so it was about discipline. You know, me going hard and being consistent, running light pole to light pole, yeah, it was about training, but more so, it was about working. And so everything I did, even when guys ran 10 sprints and I ran 20, it was more so about, I got to give myself the edge, but I also got to push myself to a limit and figure out what I'm made of. A lot of people don't even know what they're made of. And so when they hit adversity and hit opposition, the reason they crush and the reason they fall, they don't know what they possess. They don't know how far they can go because they've never pushed themselves to it. And every time they feel a little pain, they pull it back instead of saying, oh man, let me see, can I take that and move a little bit forward. And so the reason I love adversity, adversity introduces the person to who they really are. You want to see a person's true character, send them through adversity and opposition and challenge. So I just pushed myself and I locked into the process. So if I didn't get what I wanted, I still can continue to press forward.
If you didn't get your paralyzed arm, what football team would you like to draft?
Oh, man. I'll say any of them. They all paid pretty well. Yeah, I just love to play, man. I was a fan of the sport. You know, I just love the game.
Well, we're going to let this guy rest because this is his third speaking he did today. We are here tomorrow night. You can invite whoever you want and see the seats. This just tells you, we put out 1,000 tickets tonight. There might be 350, 400 people in the room. But this is an opportunity to better yourself listening to somebody like him. Let's give Inky a round of applause. Inky will hang around, so if you want to meet him, you're welcome to come on up.
Thanks for coming.